This video is about the de Broglie hypothesis, which supposedly says matter is a wave as well as a particle, and this equation that tells us how to find the wavelength of that particle. The issue is there is a very precise way to interpret the hypothesis that leads to interesting questions about quantum mechanics, but instead it's often stated in an almost meaninglessly imprecise form. Let's fix that. This video is a little more involved than the previous ones, but hopefully not too bad. And if I fail, don't worry, you don't need to understand all of this video to understand the next ones. If you do want to stick around though, I'd recommend a little revision first because it's been a while, and in particular, watch these videos if you can. Okay, so we've got this particle, it's got a wave function. Remember, the wave function of a particle contains everything we can know about that particle. For example, it might say that the particle is in a superposition of being here, here, and here. And so if you measure its position, then it will turn up in one of those places. There are these special wave functions called position eigenstates. This means that the particle really is in one spot. If you measure it, it will definitely be there. But wave functions don't just tell us about the position of a particle. It also tells us about the speed or momentum of the particle, for example. There is a way to convert the wave function from the position basis to the momentum one. When you do it, you could find your particle is in a superposition of several speeds. Here's the question we'll focus on. If the particle is going at one speed, so the wave function is a momentum eigenstate, then where is it? How do we write that wave function in the position basis? Is it a superposition of many places, or is it just in one spot? If this were everyday life, at any point in time, a moving particle is still only in one spot. But what we'll see is, even at a particular time, a momentum eigenstate is a superposition of many positions. In fact, all of them, equally. I'll show how we motivate this. Just like with Noether's theorems, we do some thought experiments about how the state could be different. Suppose we have some superposition of locations. We just imagine, what if these places had been a bit to the right instead? We'll call this offset amount delta, and as you can see, position wave functions are the same, but just delta to the right. Remember, the way we define this shift, the position is changed, but the speeds the particles are going at is not. So imagine our original wave function had instead been a momentum eigenstate. Then what happens to that when it's shifted? We'd expect this wave function is exactly the same, right? Because the shift doesn't affect the speed, and so it should still be the same momentum eigenstate. Well, actually, that doesn't mean the wave function has to be exactly the same. We definitely want it to be going at the same speed if we measure it, but that still allows a bit of freedom. Because remember, the probability of a particular speed is the length of the coefficient of the complex number sitting in front of here. Now, imagine if the state had had a negative 1 in front of it instead. Negative 1 still has length 1, and so there's still a probability of 1. What about if there had been an I there instead? That still has length 1 as well, and so it would be the same thing. In fact, if we go back to thinking of complex numbers as arrows, all complex numbers on this circle have length 1. In physics, we call these numbers phases. There's a really convenient way to represent a phase. Suppose this phase has angle theta. Using our trigonometry, we could write that as a complex number like this. Now we're just going to define the complex exponential to be this expression because it's convenient and it means that we can write down this phase just using this. One more useful fact about phases that we're going to use a bit later is that if you multiply any complex number by a phase, that's just the same as rotating that complex number by the angle. So getting back to the point, we require that when you shift a momentum eigenstate in position, it doesn't change momentum, but it may pick up a phase. This phase obviously needs to depend on the amount of shifting delta and also on the momentum, and so those two things should go into this angle. Almost done, but we need some number that's just going to scale how much this angle changes when everything else changes. So let's just pick a name for it. How about H bar? Yep, the famous quantum mechanics constant that's in all of those important equations. This is its grand entry. It's just some constant that decides how much a shift changes the phase. We can measure it in some other ways, and it turns out to be this very, very small number. Okay, we're almost there. But first, we've got to talk a little bit more about position wave functions. I've talked about the wave function when it's a superposition of a few different spots, but the thing is, a particle could be in a superposition of a whole infinite range of positions, right? What if the particle is in a superposition of all of these places, but it's more likely to turn up in this area, say? How would we represent that? Before, we put a complex number in front of each of the positions. Now we're basically going to do the same thing, but we'll assign a complex number to every single point the particle could be. In other words, a complex number for every point on the line. Assigning a complex number to every point on the line, that's just a complex function. We'll call it f of x. The bigger the complex number, the more likely the particle is to turn up around there. Complex functions are kind of annoying to draw, but there are two ways we can do it. Either we can just draw the real part and the imaginary part out separately, or we can draw it in 3D with the real bit coming out towards you and the imaginary bit going up, so all complex numbers are still just arrows. Both are useful. For people who've seen calculus before, all I'm saying is that the wave function can be written as an integral of all of the possible positions, where each position is weighed by this complex function. If that made no sense at all to you, don't worry, it's really not important. Anyway, we have this momentum eigenstate and we want to write it in the position basis. We know that the position wave function is going to be represented by one of these complex functions, but we just need to find it. Now, this is what we know. When you translate the momentum eigenstate, it stays the same, except possibly picks up an overall phase. Then, since this function f of x is the momentum eigenstate, it represents it, it must do that same thing. Well, there is a function that fits that bill, actually, and it's this complex squiggly function, where that blue bit is the real one and the red is the imaginary. In other words, this function is a complex exponential with this wavelength. Now, why is this the wave function that we're looking for? Well, you can already see it almost has translation symmetry. The function is the same if you shift it over a bit, only it's a little bit rotated. But that's exactly what would happen if you multiplied by a phase. Remember, multiplying any complex number by a phase just rotates it by that angle. And so, translating this function is just the same as multiplying it by a phase, just what we wanted. Now we've actually derived the de Broglie hypothesis. See, all it actually said was the wave function of a particle with one particular momentum is the complex exponential with this wavelength. Then, why the confusion about this wave-particle duality where people say that the particle acts like a wave sometimes and a particle sometimes? I think that the problem is that for a confusing time before quantum mechanics, people were doing things like the double slit experiment and, for understandable reasons, interpreted them using the wave-particle duality, and that's kind of stuck. But let me show you an alternative explanation using all of our current quantum mechanics. The way the double slit experiment or single slit experiment is done is just by firing particles, let's say atoms. Each atom is prepared so that it has exactly one momentum. In other words, its wave function is a momentum eigenstate. And so let's just look at the real part of that wave function, and it looks like a wave. If we have a single slit, then that wave, once it goes through the slit, will spread out, just like a water wave would. Then we measure where the particles end up. As you can see, the wave function is biggest in the middle, and so that's where each particle is most likely to land. But that's what we would have expected even if we were just throwing regular particles, you know? So people thought this is purely particle-like behavior. The double slit experiment then should be similar. Each particle goes through one slit and lands most likely right behind that slit. Of course, instead they got this. This is how you explain this with quantum mechanics. Since we don't measure which door the particle goes through, each particle's wave function is a superposition of going through both doors. That means we add the separate wave functions together. If the waves were in sync like they are at these points, because the crests meet other crests and the troughs meet other troughs, the result is a really big wave. But here the waves are totally out of sync, and so there's no wave left there at all, they cancel. The result is that there are these alternating spots where the wave function is very big and then small and then big again, etc., etc., and that gets you that right result. But instead, people thought that now the particle is acting like a wave, but it wasn't before. As you can see, our current interpretation is much more subtle, but covers both cases in the same framework. People also imagined that the particle itself smeared out into a physical wave, but somehow collected itself back up into a point particle when measured at the wall. Now we say that the particle itself is doing who knows what when it's not being measured, if it exists at all, but its wave function is the one that spreads out. Honestly, I'm not sure why people who know quantum mechanics still talk about the wave-particle duality at all. Maybe because it seems easier to explain than the wave function? But it annoys me because it makes the world sound so paradoxical that we couldn't possibly hope to comprehend it. Anyway, thanks for watching this video. I know I've been away for far, far, far too long. As a reward for your loyalty, here's some homework. Firstly, what did you think of my supposed derivation of the momentum wave function? What assumptions did I make that you think needed a bit more justification? Secondly, Niels Bohr was a huge proponent of the wave-particle duality and what he called complementarity even long after the modern form of quantum mechanics. Try and understand his interpretation of these concepts and report back. Okay, see you very soon for the Heisenberg uncertainty principle.